to the Lord, my refuge, my stronghold, my God, in whom I trust. When he calls to me, I will answer him. I will rescue him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him. He will free you from the snare of the fowler, from the destructive plague. He will conceal you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is buckler and shield. When he calls to me, terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the plague that prowls in the darkness, nor the scourge that lays waste at noon. When he calls to me,
in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
As we begin this Holy Mass, in this journey of Lent, we see with the use of incense, with the music, that we apply all of our senses to experiencing the sacrifice of the Mass. And most importantly now, we want to feel the mercy of God as he lays his hands over our heads with his words of forgiveness, in which we pray, I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, through the yearly observances of Holy Lent, that we may grow in understanding of the riches hidden in Christ, and by worthy conduct pursue their effects. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses spoke to the people, saying, "The priest shall receive the basket from you and shall set it in front of the altar of the Lord your God. Then you shall declare before the Lord your God, 'My father was a wandering Aramean who went down to Egypt with a small household and lived there as an alien. But there he became a nation great, strong, and numerous. When the Egyptians maltreated and oppressed us, imposing hard labor upon us, we cried to the Lord, the God of our fathers, and he heard our cry and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. He brought us out of Egypt with his strong hand and outstretched arm, with terrifying power, with signs and wonders, and bringing us into this country. He gave us this land flowing with milk and honey. Therefore, I have now brought you the first fruits of the products of the soil which you, O Lord, have given me. And having set them before the Lord your God, you shall bow down in his presence." The word of the Lord.
Dwell in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty. Say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Shall affliction come near your tent? For to his angels he has given command about you, that they guard you in all their ways. Upon their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the asp and the viper. You shall trample down the lion and the dragon. Thank you. because he clings to me, I will deliver him. I will set him on high because he acknowledges my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in distress. I will deliver him and glorify him.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, what does Scripture say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we preach. For if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart, and so is justified. And one confesses with the mouth, and so is saved. For the Scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all, enriching all who call upon him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Filled with the Holy Spirit, Jesus returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the desert for 40 days to be tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and when they were over, he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live on bread alone." Then he took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a single instant. And the devil said to him, "I shall give to you all this power and glory, for has it been handed over to me, and I may give it to whomever I wish. All this will be yours, if you worship me." Jesus said to him in reply, "It is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him alone shall you serve." Then he led him to Jerusalem made him stand on the parapet of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, 'He will command his angels concerning you to guard you, and with their hands they will support you, lest you dash your foot against a stone.'" And Jesus said to him in reply, "It also says, 'You shall not put the Lord your God to the test.'" When the devil had finished every temptation, he departed from him for a time. The Gospel of the Lord.
Last week we saw a video for the Capital Campaign United in Faith that outlined how the diocese itself intends to use the pledges and the funds that it receives in setting up four different endowments. Now I'm here to speak with you about how St. Louis intends to spend its part of the Capital Campaign for the pastoral support of our parish and also our continuing involvement in our neighborhood that we belong to. We have three projects to make up our part of the Capital Campaign. The first one is the pastoral and parochial support of the music ministry. The second one is repairing and updating the priest's rectory. The third is a walking path around our athletic fields that will probably be about half a mile long. First, let us look at the music ministry. What we're going to do for the music ministry is we're going to expand the choir loft 7 feet 4 inches. And as Paul Walker said, we're not doing this with the hope that they will come. They've already come. You know, we have in our music ministry nearly 70 people. We have gone from 2 people who did all the music, backed up by a few 6 to 7 other people, to now we are approaching 70 people. The 1030 choir fills the choir loft. You can get 24 people up in that choir loft, and we have 26 people in the choir. So 2 of them have to be absent for them to be somewhat comfortable up there. And then the next thing to realize is that choir lofts that were built before the Second Vatican Council, they were built for boys' choirs, not adult choirs. So you can get a lot more boys up there than you can 21st century adults. And so I think it's important for us to keep that point in mind when we look at how are we wanting to grow our music ministry and support it pastorally and support it parochially. Because I'm here to tell you, I have never seen a parish respond to its music ministry as St. Louis has. I mean, usually it takes several years for us to reach the point where we are now with about 70 people in our music ministry. We've done it in 7 months. And that's amazing with regard to how we have responded. And people continue to join the music ministry each week. And that means we have been greatly blessed here at St. Louis, and that we have the beautiful music that is a part of our worship service. And so I just think that it's amazing how people have responded to this ministry. When the choir loft is expanded, it's going to be redesigned as well. If you turn around and look at our choir loft right now, you'll find that 3/4 of the choir loft railing is solid brick. And then 1/4 of it is a railing, a wooden railing that has rather stocky posts that make up that railing. And as a result, if you stand up and turn around, you will see that a lot of the people in the choir aren't able to see what's going on down here, because 3/4 of their railing is solid brick. And so the new railing will be all wood with posts going from the top of the railing down to the floor of the choir loft. Very sturdy. I trust Victor Buck Colston making it very sturdy, but nevertheless, it will enable our choir to be able to see, because if you look up there right now, you don't see anybody's head, all right? And they don't see your head, all right? And so that's what we have to, you know, kind of look at with regard to the choir loft railing, is that we need to make it where they can see what's going on down here. Secondly, we need to make the choir loft bigger so that it can accommodate an acoustic piano. I've been a priest for 28 years. This is the only parish I've been to that does not have an acoustic piano. And we do have an electronic piano, but nothing sounds as full and nice as an acoustic piano. And we do not have one. We have a synthesizer, an elaborate synthesizer for piano sound. We don't use fake flowers here at St. Louis. We don't use fake candles here at St. Louis. We should not be using a fake piano here at St. Louis either. And so I think it's important for us to just to keep that in mind, that a good number of the parishes in our diocese do have an acoustic piano. And I'm sure one of the reasons why we do not have an acoustic piano is because of the lack of space that we do not have at the choir loft. So that will enable us to do that. We also currently are able to have two rows of singers in our choir loft. We want it to be able to have four rows of singers. When I was at St. Bridget and at Nativity Church, we had plenty of space for the choir. We usually had in between 3 to 4 rows of singers for our choir to accommodate the numbers that took part in the ministry. And we also had the space needed for instrumental accompanists, like a brass quartet or a string quartet or a woodwind quartet or a mixture of those. And here at St. Louis, we do not have the ability to do that in our choir loft. And so when I was at St. Bridget, it was a sizable area that we used. We were even able to have timpani at St. Bridget, which is definitely something that we can't do here at St. Louis. With regard to the pipe organ itself, it was installed with the understanding that sometime in the future it will be finished. And with the capital campaign that we have right now, it's an opportunity now to go ahead and finish the organ. And what it will do when they finish the organ is that, yes, it's going to add more pipes, but more pipes doesn't mean a lot more louder music. What it means is that we have in our pipe organ, a lot of our notes are on the high end scale, you know, higher notes. What we want to do is bring in lower notes in order to make the sound more full and not louder. Because when I was at, again, I'm going to use St. Bridget as an example, it has a pipe organ that is really too big for the church. But the thing is, nevertheless, it had a more full sound to it. It was not shrilly, you might say, like the one here at St. Louis. So it's a perfect opportunity to go ahead and meet that expectation from 20 years ago, and let's finish out the organ in order to give it a more deeper sound that will complete the overall sound that comes out of it. With regard to the rectory, and I've shared this with you on several occasions, now we are starting to move forward with the rectory. We have a project manager that's been assigned to the rectory. I came home one time, and there were 12 cars in the driveway, and it was all the subcontractors that were coming in to look at the rectory to see what needed to be done based on Tim DeSalvo's and my tour of the house. And so we're finally looking at moving forward with the rectory. The kitchen is a total redo. I mean, that's all that you can say about the kitchen. It's got to be completely redone. The formica on the countertops are popping off, and now you're down to the bare particle board showing itself. And then both the refrigerator and the freezer are rusted on the bottom, and the refrigerator works when it wants to. So we don't keep much in the kitchen refrigerator. We kind of spread it out to the other two refrigerators in the house. But the refrigerator in the kitchen, it has its own mind as to when it will work and when it will start resting. My bathtub, the only bathtub in the rectory, is at the pastor's suite, but it's cracked. And so there's no using the bathtub at all. Since I will be retiring from active ministry here at St. Louis, my bathroom needs to be able to be redesigned so that I can age in place, you know. So I want the grips in that shower, you know. I had that at St. Bridget. I had that at Nativity. I would like to have it here at St. Louis as well, because retirement age for me is going to be 75. And so I have 16 more years here at St. Louis. So that the bathroom needs to be redesigned for me to age in place. I got that phrase from Hometown on the HGTV network. So anyway, so the rectory just needs some tender, loving care. We're going to remove the carpeted carpet's been down for some time now. And it looks like it has been down for some time now. And we're going to replace all the carpet with LVT. Luxury vinyl tile, yes, LVT. And then the last thing that we are looking at with regard to our property is putting a walk path around the athletic fields of the parish. Like I said, it'll be about a half mile long. And we have been talking about this for the past 10 to 12 years. And again, the capital campaign is a perfect time to look at it and move forward with this walking path. It's important for us to note with regard to our neighborhood here in East Memphis, Shady Grove Elementary is closing at the end of this school year. And so the property will probably be sold for residential development, which means that the neighborhood will probably lose the park that is behind, that informs part of Shady Grove Elementary property. And so it would be a great help to our wider neighborhood if we could replace that walking path with what they're going to lose at Shady Grove Road if that property is sold for residential development, because I'm sure that the Shelby County schools need that revenue in order to support the other schools that remain in the Shelby County school system. And so it's something that we can be a part of with regard to our neighborhood and be a good neighbor for the community that's around us. Our goal is $2,066,000. And the finance council is very confident that we could go over that goal quite easily. And if we up to the goal, we split the pledges between the diocese and ourselves 50-50. When we go over $2,066,000, we split the pledges 75-25. In other words, we keep 75% and 25% goes to the diocese. And so, and the next weekend is Commitment Sunday. Some parishioners have already informed me that they have received their pledge card. Please bring that pledge card with you next week, and we will fill out that pledge card together. I will say this, because of what we are looking to do here at St. Louis, and I really want to make sure that we support our music ministry and we get the rectory up to date and repaired, that I intend to make sure that my pledge is sacrificial, you know, and that's my challenge to the rest of us. I'm going to make my pledge. This is probably the most sacrificial pledge, and this is not my first rodeo when it comes to Capital Campaign, because Nativity and St. Bridget had debt, you know, and we had a Capital Campaign every 3 years to pay down the debt and then finally to pay off the debt. And so this is probably my fourth Capital Campaign, and my contribution to this one will pale the ones that I made at St. Bridget and at Nativity will pale to what I'm going to contribute to the one here at St. Louis, because it's that important to our future and to our being a good neighbor to the wider community here in East Memphis. Thank you.
In appreciation for all that God has given to us and his goodness, we now stand as we profess our faith in him, praying, I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation, came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead in the life of the world to come. Let us pray for the needs of the church and the entire world.
For the church, that we will be led closer to God and remain his faithful children, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the grace to be aware that we may slow down, detach ourselves from the busyness of daily life, and find a quiet place to listen to God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a successful ceasefire accord between Russia and the Ukraine so that peace may be established and lives may be protected, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the church in Ukraine, that they may experience God with them, hold fast to Christ in their suffering, and to draw closer together as they give witness to the gospel, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all men and women being chosen by Christ to follow him as priests, deacons, sisters, and brothers, that they will persevere in the face of temptations against faithfulness to their call, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are ill, that healing will be given to them and that they will be helped and strengthened through the care and companionship of family and friends, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, especially Mary Olympia Costa, and for the repose of the soul of Betty Rowan, for whom this Mass is offered, that they may share in Christ's defeat of death and be clothed in the new life of the resurrection, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Father, trusting in your love and your mercy, we bring these prayers and the needs of all people in this world. We ask you to bless them with your goodness as we lay these needs before the altar of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And just briefly, sorry, not another homily, but rather than just announce what the second collection is, I want to say that having been involved in the missions for many years and being in many places where there really aren't any means to realize the needs of the local church, I'm impressed that, and also at times, honestly, maybe along with you, perturbed at the constant second collections. I know this week we've already taken up for Ukraine. Today there'll be a second collection for the African American and Native American missions. But my point is you often don't see all the good that you do by helping these people that are in great need. Now, I don't think later this week there'll be a collection for the penguins of Antarctica, but it seems like the good that you do, truly, you see that you're sharing your blessings with those that aren't as fortunate. So there will be a second collection today.
Thank you.
pray that this, our sacrifice, may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands, the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all of his church. Give us the right dispositions, O Lord, we pray, to make these offerings, for with them we celebrate the beginning of this venerable and sacred time through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. By abstaining 40 long days from earthly food, he consecrated through his fast the pattern of our Lenten observance, and by overturning all the snares of the ancient serpent, taught us to cast out the leaven of malice, so that celebrating worthily the Paschal mystery, we might pass over at last to the eternal Paschal feast. And so with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim.
Sanctus, 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 Sanctus Dominus Deus Sabaoth, plenis ut celi et terra.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Mortem tuam annuntiamus, Domine, et tuam resurrectionem confitemur, dona ac veniat.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and David our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, her holy spouse Joseph, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Per ipso, et cum ipso, et in ipso, est ibi Deo Patri omnipotenti, in unitate Spiritus Sancti, omnes honor et gloria, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Let us now gather our thoughts as we express to God our needs in these words that he himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not at our sins, but at the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer to each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Renewed now with heavenly bread, by which faith is nourished, hope increased, and charity strengthened, we pray, O Lord, that we may learn to hunger for Christ, the true and living bread, and strive to live by every word which proceeds from your mouth through Christ our Lord. I was going to say my apologies, there's no announcements, but... Stations of the Cross will be held at 5:30 on Fridays during Lent, and a penance service will be held Monday, April 11th from 7 to 8:30 with 8 priests hearing confessions. If you have a family member who is homebound or is not on our Ministry to the Sick list, please notify the church office. We would like to visit your loved one and bring communion to their home. Father Dennis Robinson, who's president and rector of St. Mildred Seminary, will speak on Monday, 21st, and Tuesday, March 22nd, at 12:30 p.m. and 7 p.m., and the topic will be, Dear God, Are You Here? Lunch will be served at 12:30 p.m. sessions, and reservation information is in the bulletin. Dr. Scott has put together a service of meditations on the Stations of the Cross and poetry and song, and will be held on Monday, March 28th, at 7 p.m. And all are expected to be here. All are welcome to come. The Men's Club will sponsor a Lenten Holy Hour on Thursday nights at 10:15 p.m. in the church, and all are welcome. Fleur de Lis will meet on Thursday, March 10th at 5 p.m. in the Clunan Center, and please make a reservation by Sunday, March 6th. And as there's always a special blessing during the Lenten season, we ask, please bow your heads for God's blessing. May bountiful blessing, O Lord, we pray, come down upon your people, that hope may grow in tribulation, virtue by strengthened in temptation, be strengthened in temptation, and eternal redemption be assured through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you and protect you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.